Thank you, guys. Good afternoon. We have been anxiously awaiting your arrival, and we're thrilled to have you this afternoon. I'm going to talk a little bit about what's going to happen for the next 90 minutes. The good news is that I am not going to lecture to you for 90 minutes because there's too much talent on this side of the room. You're actually going to be involved in a face-to-face, one-on-one, medium-high-stakes negotiation, but it's the safety of a classroom. And I want to tell you how I got interested in negotiation, and I'll probably depress you a little bit. I don't mean to do that, but then hopefully we'll kind of come through the tunnel and see the light. In our research studies, we have focused a lot on salary negotiations. We've done lots of negotiation research on other types of negotiations, but because that's top of mind for a lot of people, for a lot of good reasons, we focused on it. So now's the part where I'm going to depress you, but I really feel bad doing this, but I just feel like we have to have some focus on reality. The pay gap among graduates of elite business schools is widening. And the reason why I put this up here is because too many of the people that I work with will say, oh, we don't have any gender problems anymore. That's been solved in the 1970s. Well, female grads earn 93 cents for every dollar earned by men. 10 years ago, folks, that was 98 cents versus a dollar. So even though we'd like to think, oh, all the problems are behind us, you know, we're into, you know, a new millennium, salary negotiations determine trajectory of earnings throughout your career. I'm not an economist, but I work with people who are economists, and what they tell me is that let's assume that you get a job, you get a salary, and you have 5% annual raises. The employee offered $50,000 will earn $634,000 more dollars over a 40-year career if that person negotiates a 10% salary increase when they get their job. And that's assuming that that's the only difference between these two human beings. So what I tell my students and I tell my clients is that this is a pretty big negotiation, and there's a lot of things that you can do to prepare for it. And we're going to do an interactive negotiation. It will involve getting some feedback in the safety of a classroom, but for me, this is a great afternoon to encourage everybody to stretch themselves, right? Because this is the learning environment. And then we're going to talk about some best practices. So in other words, when you go into your next negotiation, what should we be doing? So for fun, I'm not going to put us in a salary negotiation. If I had 3 hours, I might do that, and then we could kind of go into that. But we're going to see what we can learn about ourselves, and I think a lot of us have strengths that we aren't even aware of. It's a two-party negotiation, and if you're already flipping through your paperwork, most of the folks on this side of the room are probably sellers, I'm guessing. So you currently possess a sugar bowl. That's all I'm going to say. Don't want to give away anything else. If you're on this side of the room, you are a potential buyer, and we're going to get to that. And I have a couple of guidelines before we have some fun here. You're either going to receive a buyer case or a seller case. So I think most of this side of the room is a buyer. Most of this side of the room is a seller. That's fine. I'm going to stop talking in a few minutes. I'm going to give you a chance to kind of read this case and then make whatever notes you want to make, kind of get in whatever mind frame you want to get in. I'm okay if you want to have an impromptu question, you know, talk to your neighbor and say, oh, this is my approach. What's going to be your approach? Then when I kind of ring the bell, so to speak, and I'll talk about this, I want you to find somebody with a different colored case. And that means, oh my gosh, I'm going to have to get up out of my chair. I'm going to have to walk over here into the antique artisan fair. And then I might go to Renee's stall or whatever they call these things. And so in other words, I want you to pair up with someone. Ground rule number 4, so that we can increase the reality between what we're doing in this classroom and the real world, as far as I'm concerned, you can pretty much do anything in the negotiation you want to do, except do not show your side of the case to the other party at any time in any fashion. I can tell Renee anything I want, but I can't say, hey, Renee, look at my case. This is how much I'm authorized to spend, or this is kind of how much money I have in my bank account, or, you know, this is what I do for a living. I can tell her anything I want, but I can't show her my case. So I always like to say that three times. Bullet point six is probably the most important one up there for our purposes. Just because I'm saying you're doing a negotiation today doesn't mean you have to reach a deal. You might decide, look, you're a nice person, but I'm not interested after what we've talked about or after I've heard your price. So you are under no obligation to make a deal. If you do make a deal, and what I mean by that is a transaction that is wise for you, I believe all the sellers on this side of the room, excuse me, 1 minute, Jennifer, have been given a cute little, what I call pink contract term sheet. If you do make a deal, all Jennifer has to do is get her buyer, let's say it was Alexandra, to sign this. And then Jennifer's going to give that to me. And then we can consummate this deal. So the way things are going to work is the following. Everybody has a timeline in front of them. I'm going to give you between now and 4:05 to read the case and prepare your strategy. And then between 4:05 and let's say 4:20, buyer-seller negotiations. You've got to find someone over here to negotiate with. The deadline is 4:20. And then at 4:20, I may spontaneously call upon some of you to talk about, well, what happened? Did you like what happened, et cetera? Okay, so I'm going to stop talking right now. I'm going to let you guys read your case, and then I'll give you a signal when you should try to find your counterparty. All right. We have some buyers over here who say that they're ready. We have some buyers over here that they say that they feel ready. So I get some of the sellers are looking at me like, yes. Some of you are looking at me like, no. So what I want you guys to do now is start to get out of your seat and find this vendor, find your buyer. Is anybody still negotiating? Oh, wow, this is like a really efficient group. Okay, so I looked through, I think, all the contracts that you guys turned in. I didn't see any no deals, but let me ask, were there any no deals? Wow, this is, I think, a first. Okay, so now let's have some fun. All right, so I know something about your backgrounds, but they didn't tell me who in here is an engineer. Oh, I love the engineers. Okay, Tiffany. Why does she like engineers? I like engineers because they look at the facts. They tell the truth. Now, Tiffany, you were a buyer. I happen to know that. And Tiffany, what did you learn about the seller? And by the way, who was your seller on this side of the room?
Ursula.
Perfect. Okay. Tell me what you learned about Ursula during the negotiation. Not what you learned about Ursula after you gave the pink sheet to the tall, mean professor, but what did you learn in that about 8 minutes? Okay. How motivated was she? How reasonable was she?
Okay.
Extremely reasonable.
She claimed that she was highly sought out, because she always finds pieces that people need.
Okay, so she's an expert and she is highly networked.
Yeah, she started off extremely lower than what I would expect.
Ooh, okay. But at the same, what's really interesting is that you still found her, you found her reasonable, but she's a seller. She started off low. So you kept your poker face. Tiffany, tell me you did. Okay. All right. So now, Tiffany, how low do you think Ursula could have gone? I understand that she started off with some number, but I'm saying in the darkness of the night, when push comes to shove, what do you think, what's the expression, what do you think her bottom line was? You think she could have gone down to 400. Okay. So thank you, Tiffany. All right. Now, what we're going to do is I want to go over here and I want to, Ursula, are you an engineer by training? I'm going to work with you anyway. All right. Now, Ursula, you're a seller. According to your briefing sheet, according to your case information, what is the lowest price you could have agreed to? I think it's $350. Okay. All right. So I think a lot of the buyers are now in a state of shock. So Ursula's saying she's a seller, and her bottom line, to use that expression right now, the lowest price she could have agreed to was $350. So Ursula, what's the backstory behind the $350 number? In other words, has this been a particularly good day for you at the Artisan Fair? Say no. Okay. All right. Have you made a lot of sales today? So what's the backstory with this particular sugar bowl? Yep.
I bought it for a client for $650. I got here, there was actually a blemish on it, and the client didn't want it. And so I have to.
Okay, Lindy, I like you a lot. Okay, so Lindy's saying, I'll tell you about the backstory. She got this sugar bowl, Lindy did, for another client. The client got cold feet because there's a tiny imperfectible blemish on it. And now you're willing to unload this thing for $350. Okay, thank you. Now, Lindy, we don't know the backstory with these characters over here, all right? So and who did you negotiate with, Lindy? Oh, good, that's perfect. Okay, so tell me what you learned about Samantha during your 8 to 10 minute negotiation. How motivated was she? That type of thing. How much is she willing to spend?
So Samantha was really interested in history. So before we talked places, I told her all about Paul Leggins and Newcastle and where I got the bowl from and how it was going to be a wedding gift, and I made up a lot of things.
All right. But I think it's interesting that I think there's two things that are interesting. First of all, I think Lindy is showing her expertise as a seller, right? The buyer wants to know a lot about history. That tells me the buyer is not just a commodity buyer, that she's interested in, no, tell me about this piece. And you're able to go deep with her. You're able to kind of say, let me tell you about the artist, et cetera. Okay, now let's just get right to it, Lindy. So what's the highest price you think the buyer could have paid? I'm not saying she offered you that price, but I'm saying, what is the expression? How deep was her pocket? You seem like a very intuitive person to me.
I'm thinking that I probably should have gone higher in retrospect.
But how much do you think she was secretly willing to spend?
800?
Maybe 800. And ha! Little do they know. Ha! All right, now, was there any seller over here who had a completely different experience than Lindy and is saying, my gosh, I can't believe I was doing the same exercise? Brittany? You're okay, so tell me, how was your experience different? Did you have a tightwad buyer or did you have a motivated buyer?
The problem was the seller, I think.
You're the problem? You're the seller.
That.
Right.
I prefer buying my way. But some of the numbers in my head were a little wrong than when they were on the paper. That was part of the issue.
Okay.
But I thought the budget was
That's interesting. So, in other words, you didn't match up with a buyer who might have been willing to pay $800.
No.
You didn't. Okay. Now, who are my engineering majors over here? Okay. And is it Simona? Okay. According to your sheet, your case, as I'm calling it, what's the highest price you would have secretly paid for the sugar bowl this afternoon?
$2,500.
Come again? Simona, come again? Are you saying that there's four digits? 2,500. Simona, are you within 15 paces of your ATM machine? Say yes.
Yes.
Okay. How much money is in the ATM machine and you've checked it this morning?
$3,000.
Is this an I like you a lot. Is this an emotional piece for you, or is it just something that you want to just kind of treat like a commodity? It could be a potato. It could be a soybean. Why is your heart, what's your backstory? Why is your heart set on this? How is it not like a soybean?
Because I have all the other pieces of this set, and it's not complete without it.
And have you been on a family search for decades to find the missing piece? Say yes.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So thank you, Simona. So we have over here a completely, emotional, let's say relational is the word. She's not a transactional buyer. She has been on a journey, right, through ancestry.com to find the missing piece, right? And now she's found it. She's within 15 paces of an ATM machine. Her case mentions she has $3,000 in the ATM machine, and she's perfectly willing to write a cashier's check today for $2,500. Okay, what's your point, Leigh? My point is that sometimes the sellers, because they've had this, you know, frustrating experience with this previous buyer who totally, you know, bailed out, they just want to unload this thing, and they're feeling what my clients say. They're feeling desperate. They're feeling motivated. And if the seller opens up for, let's say, by asking for, I'm going to make up a number, 600 or 700, are you ever going to get more than 700? This is not a trick question. No, right? And then all Tiffany has to do is keep that beautiful poker face and say, oh, well, maybe I can do better. Okay, Tiffany, I'm sure she's an engineer. She probably would have paid 2,500. She doesn't want to, but she probably would have, right? But she didn't. She probably didn't have to. So I'm talking quickly because this actually is my favorite part of the course, because I get to watch your nonverbal behavior when you see what happened. Now, what's absolutely fascinating to me, and by the way, where is, and I did my best to read and type at the same time, where's Rebecca? Where is stellar seller? Oh, I love that. Stellar seller, Rebecca. Okay, so Rebecca, is it true that you sold the sugar bowl for $1,050? It's right up there. I saw the contract. Now, I quickly went through all of your contracts, and I think that you are the stellar seller of the room. Oh, there's another one? Oh, $1,150. Where's Becca? Where's Becca? Okay, Becca. Becca, okay. So I'm going to talk to Rebecca. It must be like the name Rebecca. That must be the whole thing. Okay, so I want to talk to both of you about how it is that you, and notice that, you know, we have quite a range here. Some of us are at 300, some of us are at 360. I didn't type a lot of these, obviously. There's 600s, there's 500s, et cetera, but I tried to pull out some extremes. So I want to start with Rebecca and then move up here to the other Rebecca. So how did you get such a outlier sale price? You could, we know you could have gotten more, but compared to a lot of other sellers, you did particularly well. What was your opening?
So I was just like, I have this wonderful pot or whatever it was. And then I'm like, it was made by this like artisan crafter from the 1750s. Look at the design on it.
Right. So in other words, you started, you and I can see, you know, you're proud of your product. Who threw the first number on the table in your negotiation?
I think the buyer did.
Yeah. She would give me an hour.
Yeah, I kept avoiding the question. She was like, so what?
So what was her first number?
Like, well, you know, it's negotiable.
What was her first number?
800.
And I'm sure a lot of the sellers are saying, I would have liked it if my buyer would have opened up with 800. Okay, now Rebecca, I'm sure that you kept your poker face because you're secretly willing to unload this thing for 350. So what did you counter with? Let me guess. I bet you countered with about 1,200. Higher. Okay. So I bet you countered with the 15?
Yeah.
Okay. So negotiation is such a science. We can predict the final price just by knowing the buyer's opening and the seller's opening. I mean, it's not rocket science, but what I'm saying is that more often than not, that's our best predictor of the final price. It's kind of that midway in between. So I want to hear, is it Kuhu?
Yeah.
Okay. So once those two numbers are on the table, right, do you guys then, as I call it, play tennis? You go up, she goes down.
We did it just for a bit, but I went up to 950, right. And then she came down.
Right, okay. And by that time, you know that you're in what I'm going to call the bargaining zone, right? Anything north of 350, south of 2,500, it's going to happen unless one of you is psycho, which that's not okay. All right, Rebecca Genster. Okay.
I think it was pretty much the same, but I also made up a lot of lies that I think helped me.
Now, Rebecca, you're lies. Being very harsh on yourself, perhaps unnecessary. When you say it was pretty much, so just me, you're saying that there's truth in that. So I'm before we get to your lies, which I'm not sure I would classify them that way, I'm interested, same meaning, just me open first as the buyer?
Yeah.
With what number? She's embarrassed. She's embarrassed. Because I think what Disney focused
really
on is...
You get a handbag discount.
Right, okay. I'm sure... Did you open up with $1,000?
Yeah.
Okay. I think Disney read her case and she thought, oh my gosh, well, I want to be good to my family. I'm secretly willing to pay $2,500. And Rebecca, did you counter with $1,500?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Round numbers. Okay, and then...
No, you did $1,200.
No, 15 first,
oh, yeah, yeah.
And then
she did
down
15
to
first. Then she made this gracious concession, right? Okay. Now, during the time of the negotiation, tell me about these lies. I mean, because I'm not hearing them so far, Disney. I'm not hearing the lies.
Well,
I was like pointing out the competition. I said, well, she offered $1,200. Someone in the purple. It might have been you. You know, and, like.
So you were making up offers that didn't exist.
Yeah.
All right. So. You were making up offers that you didn't have. Okay, it's one thing to, you know, lie and say, boy, I'm confident somebody's going to make me an offer, but you're making up offers you don't have. We're going to get to that. Now, where is my friend? Is it Pam? And where's Pam? Okay. And who was your seller? Just okay, you guys are in the way back. All right, now, we have a different scenario here. Now, some of the class, I know you're too polite to ask this, but you're going to say, look, I understand if things get somewhat out of hand and you end up having to sell for $400. But if your rock bottom price is $350, okay, at what point did you get so, I don't know, did things get out of hand?
I was looking at just getting rid of the bull.
You're fed up with it. You want to get rid of it.
Yes. So I offered to sell it for $400 to make.
That
it
was your opening. Do you guys see how that starting point of a negotiation kind of sets you guys off on wildly different territories? And Pam, I bet your poker face was just in fine form.
I was jumping. I was like,
did you? Did you know that Pam was like ready to pay basically six times that amount? I mean, to be blunt.
No, she didn't know that.
She didn't know that because you kept your poker face, and I'm sure. Did you counter with something?
I did. I said, you know what? I found something on Amazon that was cheaper.
She lied too! Okay, because you didn't find anything on Amazon that's cheaper. All right, now, the question that I often ask. Knowing what you know now, how's the relationship? I understand you're never going to see this person again, right? Because this seems like, you know, a case where you're not going to be in a long-term relationship. But do you feel betrayed? No, no, she doesn't. All right, I'm going to talk to a couple more. Where's Christina and Sinead? Can you guys raise your hands? Good. I got Sinead over here. Where's Christina? Okay, perfect. All right, so... I see a sales price of $350, which I happen to know is right on Sinead's, what I call snapping point for now. That's kind of right, her bottom line. And Sinead, looking back now, how did things converge at that point, given that she's willing to pay, Christina is willing to pay $2,500. So when did things just... She opened with $200, which is brilliant. Notice the difference. Okay, which is brilliant. Okay. You don't want to go too far. Okay, so I'm going to repeat what Sinead is saying because it actually turns out to be really important. The very fact that Christina opened up with $200, which is, you know, I'm saying, oh, it's brilliant. It's a psychological technique called anchoring. And I think Sinead probably thought, oh my gosh, this tall, mean woman has given us a case that, you know, I'm going to have to, like, you know, kind of really go down to my bottom line, maybe even give up some more. I'm guessing that you countered with something like $400. And do you see how that, she's already so close to her point of no return. We don't know what could have happened if you would have said, that's a very interesting number, 200. I actually want to tell you why I'm asking for $1,500 for this sugar bowl. And, you know, you were very nice. But in other words, we don't know what would have happened, but that's where some of our lessons are going to be, is having the courage to make your offer, make your counteroffer that might be wildly different. Okay, Christina, anything else we should know? And did you plan that opening offer that was a stroke of genius? Okay, Christina is saying she made it up, but I think she's much more planful than that. I think that she had the stroke of genius to realize, yes, she's willing to pay $2,500. Yes, she's desperate to get this thing, but you know what? It may come to that, but she's going to open up this negotiation, picking the number that's going to serve her best, because this, now we're finding out your seller is desperate too. I'm going to talk to just a couple more. Where's Stephanie and Brittany? I don't think I've talked to you. Oh, these are my favorite ones. Okay. All right. Now, Brittany's already given us a hint that there was something, you know, kind of interesting going on. So I want to hear from Stephanie in the back why this number, 360, is a very interesting number, because notice that it's 10 bucks above the point of no return.
My point of no return was 300 on accident, now that I'm realizing.
In other words, You went into the negotiation willing to go down to 300.
That's what I thought that I paid for it at, but that's an inventory issue that we have since.
Okay. Did you make the first offer?
I don't recall making the first offer. I just remember being shocked that she was so willing to negotiate around 400 so easily. But I was just more focusing on not showing my desperation for the piece.
Right. Do you guys really not remember who made the first opening offer? Because that's key. That's key in our research, is to know.
I think I did.
You think you did?
Because you said between 400 and 12.
That's a pretty big range. That's a pretty big range.
I just remember I just started working on 4.
Right. And one of my pieces of advice for all of my clients, for all of my students, is never state a range. Right, because I'm only going to hear the end of the range that I want to hear, right? So have the guts to say 12 if that's what you want to say. Okay, let me open it up. Does anybody else have an interesting phenomenon that happened in their negotiation that you almost didn't reach a deal, or you ended up doing dramatically better, Tanika, or worse? Okay, so Tanika, help me out here. Did I type you up? Are you up here? Okay, you're up there. Tanika, which number? Ah, oh, and you, I even have a gold star on you, okay. So, but it's because the seller did a good job, unfortunately.
Everything you said, I can do
high. Okay, so Tanika, but I love the way that Tanika's kind of processing things in a way that's gonna allow her to go into her next real life negotiation and benefit from this. So, Tanika, let's formalize it. So I'm guessing that you got anchored by her. I'm guessing.
No. I went into it and said, I don't know what I'm doing. And she played the, it's okay. So what are you willing to pay?
And you said. And Tanika, did you make reference to, well, I have
2,500? And I said, well, I looked at it and saw from 4 to 1,200. And I'm thinking to myself, I can't start
too low because then she's going to say no. And I just didn't want her to say no. Okay, so Tanika, I'm actually, and I still don't know what your opening was. You said 4 to 12?
I said 1,000. I said, I'll give you 1,000.
I'll give you 1,000. Okay. And see, I think what Tanika was fearful of, and we're going to talk about this, she was fearful that if she came in with some, you know, let's say an assertive offer, let's use that word, that it would cause the seller to say, well, who do you think you are, and I don't want to deal with you, okay? And we're going to talk about some research that has to do with that, because our fears of making an offer that's attractive for us, in some sense, are usually unwarranted. The other person is not saying, well, I don't like you as a result of you asking for that. They usually say, wow, this is going to be more challenging than I thought. Let's start really kind of looking at the issues. Who is your partner over here? Okay, perfect. Okay, so she opens up with 1,000. You keep your poker face and you counter with what?
Did I counter? I was like, this is a 300% markup.
Oh, my God. All right, so excuse me. So, Tanika, the very fact that she immediately accepted your first offer, I'm sure was your... I saw that! I love it! And did you ever start to
All right, that is so funny. Okay, so Tanika perfectly has demonstrated a phenomenon we're going to talk about. It's actually called the winner's curse. The winner's curse. In other words, when my first offer is immediately accepted, I'm happy, right? I asked for something, she said yes. But then, if I think about it, negotiation means, you know, the other person's supposed to show some resistance. Okay, so let's talk about our toolbox. How many of you have heard of the term? It's an acronym called BATNA. Oh, good. Is it good? GG. I know we can read up here what a BATNA is, but how would you explain to your mom, to your sister, what a BATNA is?
Well, the performance best alternative to the negotiated agreement.
She said it's the best alternative to a negotiated agreement. And what does that mean? Your grandmother's saying, well, what do you really mean?
Both parties go away unhappy.
I think what it really means is that what's my plan B? If I don't buy Ursula's sugar bowl, what am I going to do? If I don't take the job offer that Sarah Caldwell has offered me, what am I going to do? If I don't buy Rebecca's house or sell my house, what's my plan B, right? So your BATNA is your best alternative to a negotiated agreement. Now, this is not a trick question, but in this particular case, what is the seller's BATNA? This is not a trick question. If I don't sell my sugar bowl today at 3:30 in the afternoon, what's my plan B? What?
Tomorrow.
I guess I'll just come back next week. I'll just wait and hope that somebody rolls in next week who's going to buy it. So in other words, that's my plan B. If I'm the buyer, again, this is not a trick question. If I don't buy a sugar bowl this afternoon, what's my plan B? What's my best alternative to? I guess I'll keep searching, right? Okay, so your BATNA is your best alternative to a negotiated agreement. And the point I'm driving at is that the seller has decided that, you know what? 350 is the point at which I'm indifferent between selling tonight or coming back next week. Are you guys with me? That's what I'm going to call my walkaway point. Some people call it a reservation point. The buyer has decided that, you know what? I'm willing to pay $2,500 this afternoon to get that sugar bowl. But if I have to pay more, there's actually a hint that you might pay $3,000. But if I have to pay more, I think I'll just continue my life's journey. What's your point, Leigh? My point is that, you know what? The zone of possible agreements, as we call it in B school, the ZOPA, is quite large. In other words, any number above 350 and below 2,500, unless one of us is crazy, right? And I believe me, some of my students have overactive imaginations. It's in the zone of possibility. So we have a negotiation that has a large zone of possibility. So to kind of put this in a context for the next negotiation that you're going to do in real life, the key question that I always ask my students and clients when they're preparing for negotiations, they could be preparing for a job negotiation. Some of them are preparing to buy or sell a house. Some of them might be preparing for a negotiation that might have to do with being in a study group with teammates in their class and deciding, okay, who's going to do, you know, what project work. In other words, the key question is, what happens if we don't reach a deal? Do I have another house I'm going to buy? Do I have another job offer I can take? What's my plan B? And this, I'm skipping to bullet point three. This, bullet point four, is your key source of power, is my ability to walk away. Now, I find it interesting, and I got to do a call back to Rebecca. Notice what she was doing. Is she was inventing a BATNA that she didn't have. She was saying, I've talked to a woman in a purple shirt in this classroom who's willing to pay me whatever it was, $1,200 or something like that. Somebody over here, right, we had a seller, I think, also mentioned, was this Pam, was this you on eBay? Yes, Pam said, well, look, I've already got people on eBay willing. The risk of creating BATNAs that don't exist is what? This is not a trick question. What's the risk of me saying, oh, Natalie, if you don't pay me more for this job that you're trying to hire me for, I've got another job offer from, you know, Deloitte and Touche or whoever I'm talking about. What's the risk? I'm taking, yes, Dara, great.
That they'll use their power to walk away.
That they'll use their power to walk away. So the risk is that Natalie might say, take it. Is that what you're saying? Natalie might say, oh, if Deloitte and Touche, I guess that's my example now, is offering you that much, great, I'm happy for you. Be sure to write. So I think the risk is that, what is the expression, they'll call your bluff, I think is the colloquial, you see what I'm saying? Is there another risk, danger, Megan? She might know somebody and know that you're lying. So in other words, it's what we call in business school the small world problem. We have a network, right? So in other words, she probably went to school with somebody who's at the competitor consulting firm, and she might put in a phone call. And by the way, the reason why I know this is that there have been documented cases where such a thing has happened. So then we're kind of getting into unethical. So what's my advice to you? My advice to you is to never truthfully reveal your bad nut. But what do you think? Yes?
So with this, to me, it's different, though, because ultimately, the thing that you actually do as your job is have people come to you to find products for them. So the lifetime value of thank you. As my customer, could be much greater than the $650 I used to be offering on my home share.
Okay, so I hear what Lindsay's saying, that in most, let me try to rephrase what you're saying to your satisfaction. Lindsay's saying in a lot, most of the negotiations we do, it's not a one-off, one-shot situation. That I want to, you know, create enough of a win-win for both of us so that you'll come back and buy more products from me. Maybe you'll, you know, bring another business opportunity to me. So in some sense, I should be motivated to make sure that
the price
is reasonable. So, but I still want to get back to this question. Let's suppose I'm in a negotiation. It could be a salary negotiation. It could be a home buying negotiation. It could be whatever I want. And let's say I have a BATNA. Right? Should I reveal that truthfully to Thu Hong? Well, in other words, if it's true, are you saying that I should? Well, let's take this case. Let's say that. Let's suppose in this case, should the sellers truthfully tell the buyers that if you don't buy my sugar bowl, I'm just gonna come back next week, and my minimum price is $350, but I'm hoping you'll maybe. That's true. I mean, I've just spoken the truth. Should I tell you guys that? No, because what I would do is I would say, you look like a very nice seller. I'll give you a cashier's check for $351. In other words, what I'm saying is that the minute I let the bat and a cat out of the bag, to mix a metaphor, why should you pay me but a dollar more, right? So in other words, I've lost all my leverage. I love the way you guys said, Leigh, please don't lie about your BATNA, because there's ethical issues. There are issues that Lindsay mentioned with, we're all in a small world together. Yes, is it Amy?
Amy, yeah.
Yes.
I just want to go back to the first one really quick.
Yes.
So it's actually something we were discussing right beforehand, you know, we were kind of discussing strategy, I like being really transparent. I like honesty. I like just being straightforward. I don't like negotiating. I just would rather say
right.
What I can do. And I think just kind of a real life example of that, I know somebody who put an offer. He was looking for a condo, and he found one that just kind of popped up. It was perfect for what he was looking for. They had him make an offer. He knew there were plenty of other people that were ready to make an offer. He just said, all right, I'm going to put what I'm willing to pay, what I think is fair. He wrote that down, they accepted it, and it was great all around. So he did reveal his BATNA, and it was perfect for him.
Right. As long, and what I would say is that as long as you're willing to not make any more profit than your BATNA, go ahead and reveal it. But most of the time, most of my sellers are saying to me, Leigh, I'd like to make a little bit more than $350. Just as these buyers could have said, look, I'm secretly willing to give you a cashier's check tonight for $2,500. If I were you, I would have just smiled and said, great, I'll be a nice person. I'll give it to you for, you know, $24.99. In other words, as long as you're willing to kind of not make any leverage, I think that's fine. But my point is, there's usually a ZOPA in every negotiation. Why should you be the person doing all the giving? I understand that sometimes we kind of pay, you know, relational equity or whatever the term is. I understand that your friend just didn't want the back and forth, right? And he might be happy with that, right? But what I'm saying is I think it's great that he's happy, but you never know. If you do this consistently in all your negotiations, you're not leveraging to the extent that we can. So what I tell my clients and students is send signals. Don't say, well, my actual BATNA is to pay you $2,500. What I would say, let's turn this into a job negotiation. I'm making this up. I'm making up a scenario. I have 3 callback interviews. I'm on the short list at 6 companies. I put an 85% chance on my having a Fortune 100 job offer in the next 2 weeks. So in other words, what I would do is I would signal to the other person, as long as I am on a short list, as long as I do have callback interviews, notice my words, I'm very optimistic about my future. And in other words, I have meetings, I have events, I'm optimistic. So I think the key is to signal that you have options without exactly revealing what they are. If they're fantastic, and I'd just be happy for Natalie to meet my offer, great, I'll tell her what I have. Now, what we haven't done is we haven't asked the question, well, what about assessing the other party's BATNA? I'm sure that there's lots of buyers over here who would have said, I would have loved to have known that the seller was secretly willing to settle for as little as $350. Now, I'm going to show you my favorite 3-minute film clip, and when you watch this, Tanika is going to think about her negotiation.
Blank check.
Let me see that.
You can't give a blank check to me.
An exact figure. One that's big enough so that he'll go, but not so big that he won't say, well. Wait, 27,000! 27,000, that's it! Call your father, $27,000.
Boy, Dad was relieved. He said he was afraid it was gonna be something like $200,000.
All right, so I think Tanika deserves a book for that. Larissa, do we have a book? Do we have books? Yes. All right. So this is an example of where the price that I think it's Danny DeVito's as a $29,542. You know, that's his opening offer. The dad immediately says yes. And then he feels like, oh my gosh, now that I find out the dad was secretly willing to pay more. So key takeaway of the day, know your BATNA. And figure, well, that's none of your business. My BATNA tells me when to walk, not when to sign. My BATNA tells me when it's time to go home. I don't accept the first offer that's above my BATNA, right? So many of my clients and students will say, oh, if my walkaway is $350 and somebody offers me more money, I'll get out the pink sheet of paper. No, you should just have a warm feeling in your heart that I have a feeling we will be reaching a deal today. So what I tell my students is you need to figure out your aspiration. You don't walk into a negotiation saying, I hope I get more than $350, Dara, please pay me more. You walk into a negotiation exactly like Christina did and said, well, I'm willing to pay $200, right? You walk into a negotiation like Rebecca did and say, look, I'd like to start, you know, with $1,500, and I can, you know, talk to you about all the features of this. So, aspirate. Now, I'm going to show you some of our data. When we did some scientific studies, where we looked at male and female, these were MBAs and executive MBAs. We actually had them prep for negotiation. It was very realistic. It was going to be part of their, you know, performance and so on and so forth, and it had to do with the salary and all this type of stuff. Anyway, we asked them, look, you're about to go in a negotiation. You're about to negotiate. What's your target? What's your ambition? And what we found, and I think I must have had some kind of a Freudian moment, because I put the males in pink and the females in green. Anyway, we found that if the y-axis minus to plus 0.5 is how ambitious my target point is, this is kind of in z-scores, normalized scores, the men are thinking, well, you know what? It's all about me. I'm going to ask for a lot. They're setting very ambitious targets. The same woman, well, a woman reading the same case, same prep time, same scenario, she's not setting a high target. And guys, you saw it only gets worse than that. If I go in and I say I want 2,500 for the base versus will you please give me 400, right? Now, the interesting thing is we can go over here. When we did a follow-up study in which we told our female executives and executive MBA students that, you know what? Hot newsflash. To be an effective negotiator means you need to have a lot of skills having to do with communication. You need to have skills of nonverbal acuity. You need to have skills of relationship building because negotiations are not transactional. What were we doing? We were subtly giving women the message that having skills that are in what is known as the positive female stereotype, right? Good communicators, nonverbal acuity, knowing how to build relationships, knowing how to read people, knowing how to kind of start a conversation. When we said that it's precisely that set of skills that is going to serve you, we found that women all of a sudden set better targets. So what we're finding in our research is that if women approach negotiation thinking, oh my God, I don't do that, right? Men do that. Men play football and they negotiate and, you know, and they eat corn dogs or whatever, you know, I don't know what I'm talking about. But if women were saying, well, I'm actually pretty good at those things. I've always been able to strike up a relationship with someone. Then all of a sudden they're setting ambitious targets. So what we're doing in our research is we're getting women to realize, you know what, you have everything it takes, right? So you might as well play your ace card. So now I want to talk, and we're going to come back to that. Now I want to talk about this age-old question. Should you open first or should you let her open first, right? And what we found in the research is that if you are prepared, it is to your advantage to open first. In other words, if I have done my due diligence, I believe the expression is, and I have researched Seller Catherine, I have researched Yavenna's firm, I know what houses are selling for in Sowenda's neighborhood, I feel perfectly comfortable opening first because you know what? It then becomes a psychological anchor point. If I have not done my research, I'm completely out of my comfort zone, I don't know this industry, I have no idea what people are paid in this field or whatever, then I'm not at an advantage. Now, one of the things that we find when we work with our females is that they say, if I open first and I ask for a lot, it's going to be so worried that the other person would leave the negotiation. Oh, Tanique. Okay, so what I do is I have a script. Right? I coach women to have a script. Thank you for sharing your ideas with me. I've spent time preparing a set of terms that would work for me. These are dramatically different than what you've sketched, but in the spirit of recognizing the value of your time, I'd like to share with you what would be great terms for me. In other words, put your aspirations on the table. It doesn't have to be a take it or leave it. In the spirit of starting a discussion, I'd like to put out what is an ideal set of terms for me. You probably have different ideas. I'd like to hear about them. But to not have that discussion means you're going to get psychologically anchored by their opening, which is not in your interest. So the other thing that I tell my students is not to, yes, question, Catherine.
So I guess one thing about sort of the opening is the wording. And
yes.
And that's the idea of like sort of the honesty and openness. I once had someone ask me, what's the minimum amount you can live on? Which in and of itself is probably a bad sign because it's not a person I wanted to work for. But I didn't want to move home, so. But like, so like dealing with setting high goals when
right.
wording is
right.
Put you in a position of, like,
morale. Right. And I think Catherine deserves a book for that. Okay. Catherine deserves a book for that. All right. So if someone asked me what is the minimum amount you can live on, I would smile and I could say, yeah, I could see why you'd want to ask me that. What I want to do is I want to get back to talking about what would be a great set of terms for me to bring to this position. Right? I understand that you know, what have your own set of interests, but I want to put out what I'd be really excited to do. In other words, I even had a student once in a negotiation say, will you show me what's the maximum amount that you'll pay me? And, you know, you go first. Now, that, I'm not necessarily advising that because then you start to play some kind of interesting psychological chess game. But what I would do is I would smile and I could say, that's a really good question, but I want to talk about what I would do for this firm. And I would join right now if these were the terms. I understand we need to have more of a discussion. So in other words, what I'm politely saying is I'm not answering that question. I understand why you're asking that question. I'm not answering it. Natalie?
I've had in the past that I've had a salary topic come up. Because the first thing that they would ask me is how much are you currently
right.
and how much do you want to make? So it's like
two answer questions. The second question. Right. I would just,
if you
yeah.
don't, like, give them an answer of how much you're making.
I don't want to be avoidant, but my current salary is not reflective of my current skills and what I can bring to this firm. We could have that discussion, but I'm concerned about anchoring on something that I don't think is a valid indicator. I'm not avoiding anything. Just like, let me tell you why that's probably not the way to go here. Let's talk about what I can do. And I've researched your firm. I'm so excited about this initiative. I have a unique skill set that I can bring to that. I've researched some of the part. I'm kind of making things up. The partners that you're working, Abigail.
So for the application itself, oftentimes asks, what's the desired salary? Is it recommended to put an overtime there? Is it recommended to have a blank? Or is it recommended to
desired salary?
Desired salary.
Oh, Abigail's asking a really good question. I always fill in desire. Right, the reason why I always fill in desire is that anytime anybody's interested to know what my aspiration or target point is, I love to put that out there because I know about psychological anchoring. I know that if I never ask for $2,500 for my sugar bowl or, you know, whatever we're talking about, I'm never going to get it. I'm happy to put in my desire. Yes?
So sometimes I worry about that in the sense that
you're going to ask for too much.
Right, I still want the interview for,
right.
to prove to them that I am worth that.
Right, and that's where the research comes in. So, and I'm going to get technical for just a second. So in other words, if we had more time, which we don't have, a question on my final exam, so if you come to Kellogg, you're always going to get an A because this is a question on my final exam. In my negotiation question, in my negotiation classes, what is the ideal opening offer? The wrong answer is like, I'm going to ask for like $10,000 for my sugar bowl. That's the wrong answer because then the seller's going to say, okay, I'm dealing with psycho. The buyer's going to say, I'm dealing with a psycho seller. The ideal opening offer should be on or near what I think your actual batten is, Abigail. In other words, if I have insight into your low or high price, well, let's talk about, you know, if you're a firm. If I have insight into you could pay a new hire this amount, I want to be the person asking for that because that's already in your zone of acceptability. So that's why you want to do some research. That's why I always tell my students and clients, tell me all the research you've done, right? And they're usually under research. They're usually asking their friends in casual conversations, which is great. But asking 2, 3, 4, 5 friends is not nearly as valuable as getting a much more quantitative data, right? Because then you're not going to be under-aspiring. All right, so let's talk about gender. I can't wait to talk about this. So I've already shared with you our research that women set less aggressive goals. And what I mean by less aggressive goals is when we do research in which we give men and women the same case and the same bat net and the same time to prepare, and then we ask them, what's going to be your opening offer? Or even, how much would you want? What's your desired thing? The women set less aggressive goals, right? They don't, because they don't ask for as much during negotiation, they don't perform as well. And what I mean by perform as well is that in our salary negotiations, they don't get as much. In a sugar bowl negotiation, they don't get as much. And of course, if they're buying, then they pay too much. And here's the kicker, sub-bullet point number three. In negotiation situations in which it's kind of ambiguous, meaning that today wasn't ambiguous, right? It was like, go find a seller and start to do the negotiation. You know what? Life doesn't often come to us in that way. Life often comes to us in that we get a phone call out of the blue, and then, oh my gosh, you know, I wasn't prepared for this, and it's happening, and no one is even using the word negotiate. But I'm being asked, you know, what my desired terms are. What we find in those more ambiguous situations is that men immediately turn on what I call the what we call the negotiation tape, and women don't. Women often say, look, you'll realize how valuable I am to this company, and then I will be rewarded in due time. And men are the first to negotiate. So why is this, we asked. Maybe there's some basis in reality. Women believe that assertive behavior will elicit a negative response. If I ask for what I really want, there could be a backlash. Or maybe they'll never even invite me in for the interview, some of us worry about. I'm going to depress you again. Women, there's a research study that in which women were told to, you know, ask for something, and they were not perceived as positively as compared to the men who asked for the exact same terms in a negotiation. And it turns out male evaluators penalize female candidates more than male candidates for initiating negotiations. Women who ask sometimes are seen as less nice and more demanding, right? Because they've violated the female stereotype. Women are often less inclined to negotiate with a male evaluator because they are more nervous. And I guess what I'm saying is that unfortunately there tends to be some seed grain of truth in that, right? In other words, in the research studies, women are saying, I'm not sure I want to go in there and kind of start to really push and ask because I'm worried that I'm going to be negatively evaluated, and some research is suggesting that's true. So the question is, what bless you, what to do? Well, I think the key, there's a couple of keys. One key is to remove the ambiguity, because what we're finding is that if we all know that this is a negotiation, then somehow we aren't judging each other when we start to negotiate. So when we have done some studies in which we remove what's called the structural ambiguity, right? And people start to define it as a negotiation, women tend to do better. So women tend to do better when the situation is unambiguous. So a lot of times what I've learned to say is, look, sounds like we're talking about the book project, sounds like we're talking about the teaching schedule, sounds like we're talking about the work project. Notice that I'm naming things that are not classic negotiations. If I'm buying a house, give me a break. We all know we're negotiating. But you know what? If we're negotiating teaching schedules or the book product or the authorship or something, you know, a lot of times I try to, you know, so let's have a meeting on Thursday. We'll negotiate authorship, we'll negotiate teaching schedules. In other words, what I try to do is I try to say, look, we're meeting for a tennis game on Thursday. Come with your ideas. Because by removing that ambiguity, it permits us to start saying things like, well, this is good for me. I have childcare issues, so that's why I want to teach in the afternoon. Or whatever my driving force is. here's the one that I love the most. I'm going to tell you about it. Don't read this junk. Don't read that junk. I want you to predict the results. When we do studies in which women are negotiating in a one-on-one classic situation, buyer-seller, right, recruiter-candidate situation, and they're told, look, you know, do as well as you can for yourself. And then we have another group of women doing the same negotiation, but we tell them to negotiate on behalf of someone else. You're doing this on behalf of a team, on behalf of a constituency. When do the women tend to do better? When it's what? What? Okay, someone else. And is it Chadi? I can't read it. Sherry deserves a book because Sherry's instinct. We have books for Sherry. Her instincts are right. All right, so why is that, Sherry? Your instincts are right, spot on.
Because I think that we, as a whole, when we're sweeping, we tend to be more nurturing and feel like we can step back and fight for somebody else where we won't fight for ourselves.
Right. And so thank you, Sherry. The very fact that we haven't changed the negotiation at all in this research study, all we've done is just created a mental group. We've created a mental group. So this is why some women who aren't even married, there's research studies indicate women who aren't even married will put on a wedding ring to walk into the car dealership. I have to call my spouse. I have to call my partner. It's what I call the faux partner, right? Right, in other words, you're creating, and it's based on, right, that's why the car dealership guy has historically had the advantage because he always needs to check with the guy in the back room. Are you know, right? So in other words, why don't I create my own back room? I can put anyone I want in my back room. Who else had a question up here? Someone had a question, yes. Yes, way in the back. Right. In other words, you kind of like are thinking, oh my gosh, Leigh, I'm already on the trajectory on your first slide. Well, that's kind of a personal story to me, Kathleen. I have my own personal situation where in my very first job in life, I will not name the institution. You can look it up if you want. I did just that, right? I did just that. I took it. And then, get this, one night I'm working late. You know me, I'm the workaholic in the office working late. My female colleague pokes her head in the room. Leigh, you're underpaid. I am? I don't even know it because I'm just working too hard. You're underpaid. And I said, what do I do? And she just said, this is a public institution. I went to the library that night in a public institution, in a state-run institution. Salaries are a matter of public information. I went to the library, collected data. I made Excel charts. I made bar charts, and I just, it was all objective. It was like, here's when I entered, here's what I, and I went into my chairperson, right, that week, and I presented the data. I didn't go in saying, I said, look, I have some questions. I've put together this information. Help me understand. Within 3 days, I got a call from the dean of the school saying, we have a salary increase. So, I found, what's the takeaway? It was, in some sense, it wasn't too late because I collected my information. I made a fact-based case. I asked. They aren't going to come into your office and say, oh, Sarah, we want to pay you more. But I got a tip-off from a female colleague who, you know, gave me that information. So I want to tell you about our crazy research on what I call the gorilla effect. And hopefully you see a theme so far, which is, you know what? Anything that's not out in the open, to me, can hurt you. In other words, if they're asking questions that it's like, oh my gosh, I don't want to answer that, but how do I know, you know, how do I let them know I don't want to answer that? And, you know, I kind of believe in kind of saying, seems like we're avoiding this topic. So what is the gorilla effect? What we found is that men and women unconsciously confirm, in other words, they tend to fall prey to gender stereotypes when they're activated implicitly, but when they're explicitly activated, people will say, well, you know what, that's not me. So we did a study in which we found that women do a lot better in negotiations when they and others acknowledge that cultural stereotypes exist about women's ability to negotiate. So in other words, what we found in our research is we kind of had three test groups. We had a control group. This is all the salary negotiation, executive MBAs, MBA students. We just said, look, you know, go in and negotiate. That was our control group. Then we had what I call a unisex group. This was hysterical to me. We basically said negotiation is an androgynous skill. You need to be half man, half woman, so to speak, right? I mean, it wasn't that ridiculous, but it was kind of like, oh, you need to kind of have a right brain and a left brain, stereotypically. And then we had a guerrilla group, and we said, you know what? Negotiation is a domain, is a skill in which there have been pretty clear cultural assumptions, pretty clear cultural gender stereotypes about who's able to do this and who's not. That's all we said, is that you're getting ready to go into a situation in which culture and life has already, in some sense, stereotyped you. And what we found, and I want to go over here to the y-axis, this 0 to plus 4,000, 0 to minus 4,000, higher bars meant the women did better relative to the men. And what we found is that in the guerrilla group, the women were saying, well, just watch me. You say that this is a cultural landmine? Well, guess what? I've got on my gear, and I'm ready to go, and I'm not playing that game today. You've already told me, you know, that there are gender differences, but you know what? Not for me. So in other words, what we found, and this is kind of a paradoxical effect, is that we kind of made it clear that, you know what, some people actually think that this could be true, that, you know, maybe it's a, you know, negotiation is a man's domain. And what we found is that our women are saying, well, you know what, just watch me then. So in some sense, what we found in our research is that if you leave things ambiguous, if things are unspoken, it starts to kind of unconsciously backfire. And that's why, you know, a lot of times what I do is I say, look, I'm a really blunt communicator, and I need to ask some questions, because it's hard for me to navigate, you know, situations unless I start to put some structure around this. Okay, so I think I mentioned this research. This is negotiation performance. Over here, we have, if the higher the bar, it means the man is doing better. And what we found is that, again, under controlled, normal conditions, men seem to prevail. But the minute we start talking about any kind of stereotype, women do better, because they're like, look, I'm going to think about this. I'm either going to defy it or kind of, you know, put my best foot forward. So a couple of best practices. Number one, plan your opening offer and carry it off. I actually, when I coach my female students and male students, I have them write their opening offer, put it in their breast pocket, put it in their purse, and at some point, I need to follow through with the script. Just like Natalie, it's been great talking about, you know, the weather, and been great talking about the interesting things going on in your city. I'm going to begin, in the interest of recognizing your time. Bullet point number two, never, ever, ever ask, is this negotiable? Just start negotiating. And what I do is I announce, just as like, look, I'm going to begin by kind of talking about what would work here. And I imagine you have different ideas, and let's kind of proceed. We've talked about, this is Sherry's point, imagine yourself negotiating on behalf of someone else, your department, your children, whether they're conceived enough or not. A favorite one is negotiating on behalf of your retired self, right? Who's that 80-year-old person that you're taking care of? I think it's interesting research. Women who negotiate online for cars get better price quotes than when in person. I don't know what that tells us. We have some corroborating research, and it's something about if you're online, you have more time to prepare, you have more time to think, it isn't kind of in the moment. And we've talked about thinking of negotiation as very much my skill set. All right, so we're going to do a very quick exercise. Some of you are saying, no, we're supposed to have a break. Make her go away. I want you to pair up with someone sitting either behind you, in front of you, or next to you. And I want you to get close to this person so much so that you can put your hand on her shoulder. Don't worry, this isn't weird. Just go. It's not weird. It's not weird. Go. Okay. Now, everyone's found a partner. I want you to imagine that you don't speak the same language. So you're not going to have a big conversation. It's all going to be your body. Don't worry, it's not weird. It's not, you should see what the men do. They're like, oh, my God. Okay. All right, if you're holding a pen or pencil, put it down. You're unarmed. You're unarmed. All right? Now, at this point, no talking, no writing. It's all nonverbal. It's all body, body, body. I want you to get in an arm wrestling position. You're not exerting any force. You're getting poised. Shh. No talking. You're poised. When I give the signal, which I have in no way given Eunice and Renee and Ursula, when I do give the signal, your goal is to get as many pin downs as possible. And those of us who've been in the gym at 6 o'clock in the morning, finally it's going to pay off. Finally it's all going to pay off. Okay, Okay, close your eyes, actually. Close your eyes. You're blind. You're blind. Don't stop looking at me. On your mark, get set, go! As many wins as possible! Keep going! Keep going! Keep going! Keep going! All right, stop! Stop! All right. So Tanika wants to know, where are the orthopedic surgeons when we need these people? Okay. How many of us have a score of zero? Raise your hands. I saw you. This is what I saw. I just saw. Okay. How many of us have a score of 8 or more for me and 8 or more for my counterparty? Okay, Debbie and Virginia. Instant replay, Debbie and Virginia. Do it again. On your mark, set, go. Can you watch them? Do you see what they're doing? When, and how many of us were trying to... I love that. Did anyone over here have a win? Right? This is Lindsay's final exam. She says, look, if we're reasonable, then we may come back for business with each other. Okay. So what's the takeaway? Did anyone, I'm going to take a break in just a second. Did anyone try to send a signal to their partner that, look, we can either do this the hard way or we can do some negotiation? I love that. I mean, just we're so competitive. All right. So Debbie and Virginia, how did you guys do this? Okay, and so Debbie got the picture that Virginia's trying to tell you something. Maybe we can work that. And Tanika, I'm dying to know what. I'm just dying to know. No! Did you try to kick some butt? Yeah! Right. And by the way, Debbie and Virginia deserve books. All right, so what I want you guys to think about is the next time you're in a negotiation, check that gut instinct. Yes, it's all about me, but you know what? We need to, you know, and by the way, letting you take all the wins is not the quid pro quo. So I have given you guys, by the way, this is not a bookmark. I guess it could be. It's a wallet card. It has all the takeaways that we've talked about. What I'd like you guys to do is think about what one thing you want to do differently next time, next month. In other words, don't do 14 things differently. Don't say, oh, I'm going to do, you know, badness, and I'm going to do Zopas, and I'm going to do all this stuff. Just say, look, I'm going to really try thinking about my badness. And maybe the month after that, you really try thinking about how do I figure out how to put my offer on the table first and make sure that I'm not making too deep of concessions. All right, so I'm going to power myself off here, and I just want to take a minute to thank you guys from the bottom of my heart for being such an engaged group, and thank you guys so much for doing this negotiation, and I know I exposed you guys up here, and I'm so glad that we had such a great learning environment. You have a friend at Kellogg, and I hope our paths cross many, many times. So thank you guys so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.